Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the fabulous state of South Carolina. I've been praising the Lord all day, brothers and sisters. I've been wanting to make a video in a way, but I just didn't want to break away from my fellowship with the Lord, brothers and sisters. As we talk about, last video, but trying, we've got to go up on the mountain, brothers and sisters. You have to see the kingdom of God as a mountain, brothers and sisters. Those who are not on the mountain, of course, they're not saved. When you get saved, you're on the bottom of the mountain. You have to go up and up with your walk with the Lord, with your sanctification, with your unity among the brethren, as you learn to separate yourself. You know, as the old song says, the world behind me, the Lord before me. No turning back. We have to turn our eyes upon Jesus. And the things of this world grow strangely dim. That's a different song. I wanted to read something to you, brothers and sisters, from Hebrews chapter 8. Starting at verse 1, as I mentioned last video too, about the Lord at this time as our high priest until he comes back as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Right now, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father as a high priest. Let's see what the Bible says. Hebrews chapter 8. Now, of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not man. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices. Therefore, in modern English, it is of a necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law. Now, when Hebrews was written, it was before the temple was destroyed. That's what he's comparing the earthly priesthood to the priesthood of Aaronic priesthood. He's comparing that, the descendants of Aaron, to the Melchizedek, the priesthood of Melchizedek, which Jesus is a high priest after the order of Melchizedek, the Bible tells us. Let's see. Who served unto the example and the shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou makest all things according to the pattern shown to you in the mount. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, that's Jesus, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant. Brothers and sisters, I haven't talked about this in a while, but it's a better covenant, which was established unto better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he said, behold, the day comes, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws in their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me my people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor, but every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins, and their iniquities I will remember no more. In this he saith, a new covenant. He hath made the first old, now which is decayed and waxes old and is ready to vanish away, brothers and sisters. Well, first of all, brothers and sisters, I want to tell you we have a better covenant. And Jesus is our high priest, seated at the right hand of the Father, ever making intercession for us. Blessed be the name of the Lord God Most High. I've been praising and worshiping the Lord all day, brothers and sisters. I've been ministering to people that the Lord has led me to minister to. And, every day I want you to, when I was in the Philippines, of course, I'm still overseeing the orphanages from here through Facebook and emails and all these things and Skype. But also here in the States, brothers and sisters, I'm busy every day ministering to our brothers and sisters in the Lord. So praise God for that, that the Lord would give me the wisdom and the energy and the time to do all that. But the greatest thing I like to do, of course, is that it will be on earth as it is in heaven, that I would spend time at the top of the mountain, brothers and sisters. As I mentioned last video, you need to come on up the mountain, brothers and sisters, and get closer to the Lord. Hallelujah. But first you have to let the guilt and the shame, the biggest thing I deal with, You got your greasy gracers on one end who think they can do whatever they want, live in sin, live like the devil, live like hell all their life and go to heaven because they said a prayer one time when they were 8 years old. But lots of people who watch my videos are on the other end, brothers and sisters. They're trying to live in perfection and we can't. But we have the God knows the thoughts and intents of our heart. He knows the thoughts and intents of our heart. You will never be perfect as long as you're in the flesh. You will still have your sin nature in your flesh. As Jesus said to the disciples, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. That's what the Lord is looking for, that your spirit is willing, that you're a willing vessel. You offer yourself as a living sacrifice, Romans chapter 12, acceptable unto God. Submit yourselves under his hand. He will give you strength. He will help you overcome by his spirit. These things are not done by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. He's the one that will lead you there. So first of all, you have to know that God loves you, that Jesus died for you. Yes, and every time we sin, we don't lose and regain your salvation every 5 minutes, every time you sin and repent. It's a repentant attitude and a repentant heart. You know, the spirit has to be willing. That's what the Lord is looking for, a willing vessel. Not a perfect vessel. You'll never be perfect until the resurrection. But a willing vessel, willing to submit yourselves unto him, under the mighty hand of God. That's why you have to listen to the song that's been in my spirit. I've been praising the Lord all day. My voice is a little bit hoarse, but it's this song is called Blessed Assurance. Maybe you don't know it. It's a hymnal song. And I'm going to put some links on here, brothers and sisters, to an anointed church of God that sings a cappella. Like I've told you, those who have been watching my videos, you can go to a dead church and they can sing all the latest worship songs that you know that are anointed. It's going to be dead. It's not the song. Any song that's commissioned by God, including all the old hymnals and the psalms from the Bible, modern day worship songs, any song commissioned by God is going to be anointed when it's sang by an anointed singer. It's the anointing of the singers that brings the anointing to bear in that song. Or God would either that or God wants you to be anointed when you hear it, and you will be anointed. But when dead people try to sing a living song, it is also like them. As it comes out of their dead spirit, it is also dead, brothers and sisters. So I found some awesome, anointed hymnal music, praise God, that the Lord led me to that I put on here. One of them is called Blessed Assurance. And it's like this. I can't really sing, brothers and sisters, you know that. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Blessed be his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lord God on high. Hallelujah. He is worthy, brothers and sisters. He is worthy. That's why it says, what have I to fear? What have I to dread? Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet it is to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Praise God Almighty, brothers and sisters. You have to lean on the everlasting arms of the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to know that blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Hallelujah. Heir of salvation. Hallelujah. Purchased of God. Filled with his spirit. Washed in his blood. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord God on high. Hallelujah. You know, you got to praise his name. I sing praises to your name. Oh, Lord, praises to your name. Oh, Lord, For your name is great and greatly to be praised. Give honor to his name. You got to praise him. You got to praise him. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people, brothers and sisters. I've been with the Lord all day since I got up this morning, just worshiping him. The Lord's just giving me words for people. I just got on YouTube, and there's people who didn't even ask me. The Lord said, give them this word. Give them this word. Give these people this word. You know, just flowing in the Spirit of God. That's where it is, brothers and sisters. You got to come up the mountain. Get out of your flesh. You know, yesterday, the last video I made, I talked about being slain in the Spirit, and I said, you know, it's a biblical. People try to say it's not biblical. It is biblical. As I mentioned, when John saw the resurrected Christ, the name of the video is the Revelation of Jesus Christ. When John, the apostle, saw Jesus, whom he walked with for 3.5 years, he felt as if he was dead at his feet. When Ezekiel saw the Lord, he felt as if he was dead. Daniel felt as if he was dead. All these men of God, they felt as if they were dead at the presence of God. And I made that video. Then the next day I was out and about doing a prayer walk. And the Lord just spoke to me and said, you know, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. To be saved. You know, I saw one time there, this Christian bookstore had a Christian t-shirt that said, a dead man walking. And it had the text, I believe it's Galatians 2:28, I think it is, where it says, you know, it is not I that live, but Christ that lives in me. You know, my flesh is dead. Paul said I die daily. We're supposed to be crucified with Christ. You know, so when someone falls in the presence of God like John did in Revelation, it's if that flesh is dead. It's dead. We are dead with Christ. That's what we do when we do water baptism, brothers and sisters. As the Bible tells us, we're buried with Christ and resurrected with him. Our flesh we leave in the water. Our flesh we leave on the cross. You know, at the cross where I first saw the light. And the care, the burden of my sin was rolled away. It was there by faith that I received my sight. Hallelujah. From the Lord at the cross where I first saw the light. Hallelujah. The Lord has set us free. That's when we bury our flesh. You've got to get out of your flesh. Your flesh cannot go up the mountain, brothers and sisters. It's only the spirit man or spirit woman that can go up the mountain. Now, when we get resurrected, we get our resurrected bodies, a.k.a. the rapture. All right, then. That's a whole different thing. We have that incorruptible new kind of flesh, like what Jesus had after the resurrection. He could walk through walls, but yet he could eat. He ate fish. He ate honey. But he walked through walls. Resurrected body. Right now, we're not in a resurrected body. Right now, our spirit has been redeemed. Our spirit man has been resurrected. And that's what the Lord was telling me about when I talked about people dying. The Lord also told me it's a revival, or when you get saved, you're spiritually resurrected. You were once lost and without hope in this world. Strangers and enemies of the covenants of God, the Bible tells us. Lost and without hope in this world. Before you got saved, before you came to the cross where you first saw the light, where the burden of your sins was rolled away, it was there by faith. I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the days. Hallelujah. Because of the blood of Jesus, you're not your own. You've been bought with a price, the Word of God says. Hallelujah. Therefore, sanctify yourselves. Hallelujah. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he will give you strength. Brothers and sisters, we've been spiritually resurrected when you get saved. And then when you get revived, you're resurrected. Your spirit is resurrected, revived. Just like the Lord has given me the Bible verse when Jacob, who is also Israel. Here's a clue for you. When the Lord says Jacob, he's talking about the natural man. Just like when Jesus talks about himself as the Son of Man, he's talking about his time on earth. When he talks about the Son of God, he's talking about his time in heaven. His time is ruling and reigning. Son of Man is when he's on earth. Son of God is in heaven. Jacob. When Jacob is doing something in the flesh, he's Jacob. When Jacob is doing something as a type of Christ, when Jacob is doing something spiritual, he's called Israel. God calls him Israel. He who wrestles with God and man and overcomes. When Joseph came to see Israel to receive the blessing for his sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, it said that Israel revived. Israel revived. He set up when Joseph came in. Hallelujah. Of course, Joseph, of course, is also a type of Christ. And, you know, the Lord's reminding me of that now. That's what the Lord had talked to me about several things about that. Let me see what it was. Just this morning. You know, that's how the Lord is. He'll give me these. I got all these bits and pieces and nuggets that the Lord gave me. But it's all interconnected. I had no idea to start making the video. You know, Joseph, of course, was sold by his brethren. Joseph was sold by his brethren for 20 pieces of silver. The Lord Jesus, of course, was sold by one of his brothers, by Judas. Many types and shadows. What happened the second time when the children of Israel, the brothers of Joseph, went to go see Joseph in Egypt? The first time, Joseph did not reveal himself that he was the one whose Savior. And the name that the Egyptians gave him, Zaphnath-Paneah, means he will save his people in Egyptian. Yeshua is he who saves. You know, that's the same thing, but as another type and shadow. So the second time the brothers of Joseph went to see him, then Joseph revealed himself to his brethren. So the second time when Jesus comes back, he will reveal himself to his brethren. Many, many types and shadows of Joseph among his brothers. And his father said, as the Lord is just reminding me now, you know, when Jacob said, this son of mine who I was dead, he's back again. He's alive again. Joseph was dead to Israel. The Messiah is, you know, Jesus is dead to Israel, but he's coming back. They will be resurrected. You know, he'll come back at the second coming to his people. And Israel will sit up. Israel will be resurrected. Israel will rise again, brothers and sisters. But until that day, brothers and sisters, we are in the age of the Gentiles. The time of the Gentiles has not been fulfilled. You know, that's really the message of this video for those who need to hear. Those who have an ear to hear, let them hear. And for those who need to hear it, we are not in the age of the nation of Israel, brothers and sisters. We are in the age of the church, the Gentile church. The time of the Gentiles has not been filled yet. We, the church, the born-again believers in Yeshua, the bride of Christ, have not gone on yet. You know, we're waiting, watching and waiting, looking above. Hallelujah. You know, there's another verse in there, where that song, it says, you know, visions of wrath should not burst on my sight, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, washed in his blood. So brothers and sisters, we're waiting because our redemption is drawing nigh. We're ready to depart out of this world just as Jesus did. We're ready to depart out of this world. That's why we have to separate ourselves. Just like Jesus, it says in John chapter 13, it's the stuff that the Lord has given me. I never even looked at it that way. That's the thing about the Holy Spirit. He'll show you something. He'll show you the Bible verses. You never even thought of it that way until the Lord would open your eyes, just like he did on the road to Emmaus. He opened their eyes when they got to the house and he broke bread. Boom, they saw it was Jesus. They didn't know it was Jesus they were talking with. When Jesus was about to go into the Last Supper in John chapter 13, starting at verse 1, it says, when Jesus was about to depart out of this world. You know, and just before that, you know, Jesus had gone to the Gentiles. He said, I didn't come for the other people, only for the nation of Israel, you know. And then it wasn't time. First, Jesus said, I must first be rejected by this generation. So Israel had to reject Jesus as the Messiah, which they were in the process of doing that through the time of the crucifixion. Particularly that last week, Passion Week, they rejected him. From Palm Sunday, they laid down palms and said, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And then by the Wednesday or Thursday, not on Friday, that's what the Catholic tradition is, but probably Wednesday or Thursday, the Lord was crucified because he spent 3 days and three nights in the ground. Full 3 days and three nights. Whole nother conversation. But whatever that would come out to, that's when it was, Wednesday or Thursday. You know, who cares? I don't debate. It doesn't matter. If the Lord wanted us to, you know, to know what day it was and make a big deal about it, then he would have written in the Word. Anyhow, they had to reject him. So it tells us, as the Lord is prompting me right now, in John chapter 12, one of his disciples came to him and said, hey, I don't know if he said hey, but he said, you know, there are some Greeks who want to come meet you and talk to you. Some Gentiles. God works in reverse, brothers and sisters, for us today. The Gentiles came to him, and the Lord immediately started saying, groaning in his spirit, saying, you know, Father, glorify your name. And then they heard the voice of God. Some heard thunder. Some thought it was an angel. He said, I've glorified it. I will glorify it again. And then Jesus, it says it was time for him to depart out of this world. Why? Because he had already dealt with Israel and the Gentiles were starting to seek him. Brothers and sisters, today the Gentiles is a falling away, and now there are Israelites who are turning to the Messiah. They're looking for the Messiah. I just heard on a radio program, a secular radio program that I turned it past on the radio. It was Michael Savage. And I turned it on the radio when I went to the grocery store, and there was a ultra-Orthodox rabbi that called in, and he said, you know, and this is, and I already heard this from other people, but I haven't heard it from the mouth of an ultra-Orthodox rabbi. And he said, of course, what I've been hearing from Gentile preachers who go to Israel a lot, they say, you know, we are in the age, in the period, the window of redemption. We are looking for Mashiach. Of course, the Antichrist will come. They will make a covenant with him, but they'll think he may be the Messiah. They won't be sure. But in the middle of the tribulation, at the end of 3.5 years, the Antichrist will go into the rebuilt temple up there on the Temple Mount where they're offering sacrifices. He'll put an end to sacrifices. He will walk into the temple, probably sacrifice a pig on the altar as a type of this Epiphanes, Andias Epiphanes the Fourth did back in before the time of Christ, about 150 BC. And he will declare himself to be God. And then Israel will know, hey, this is not the Messiah, for sure. They will reject him. They will flee to Petra. That's a whole nother, I made lots of videos on that. He will kill the two witnesses, go into the temple and declare himself to be God, offer the abomination that causes desolation. No, it's not the inauguration of some U.S. president. The U.S. president has nothing to do with what's going on in Israel. All the prophets spoke in relation to Israel and the countries around Israel and the countries that had rule over Israel. So the abomination of spoke the abomination that causes desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet is what happened in a type of this Antioch Epiphanes in about 150 or 165 BC when he went into the temple, set up an altar to Zeus, a statue of Zeus, and sacrificed a pig on the altar, therefore contaminating the temple. That's why Israel has the holiday, extra biblical feast called Hanukkah, the festival of lights, because they only had one day of oil and it takes 7 or 8 days of oil to cleanse the temple. And the oil miraculously lasted the days it took to cleanse the temple that was contaminated, that caused desolation by the blood of the pig and the statue of Zeus offered by that guy mentioned 2 or 3 times in about 165 BC. So the Antichrist, and then Jesus spoke 100 and almost 200 years after that fact and said that wasn't the fulfillment of it. There are people who are totally confused and can't understand the concept of time, who are what they call all of millennials. They don't believe in the millennial reign of Christ. They will tell. They think, because they don't understand the Bible anyway, they don't take it literally. They believe that the fulfillment of the abomination that causes desolation is happening in 165 BC. The fulfillment of the words from the book of Daniel. But our Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, he said 150, 200 years after that event, he said to his disciples, to the Israelites. He was talking to Israelites in that text, as a matter of fact. He said, when you see the abomination that causes desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, therefore, it's a future event to the time that Jesus walked the earth, not a past event, a future event. When you see the abomination that causes desolation, the desolation of the temple, they won't be able to offer any more sacrifices. As Daniel also tells us, he will cause the sacrifices to be ended. Why? Because he will do an abomination that will desolate the temple. He will desecrate the temple. It will become unclean by sacrificing a pig or whatever he does and setting up an idol in there, a statue of himself, the image of the beast, causing all, both great, small, rich, and poor, bond or free, to worship the image of the beast and take his mark, 666. That happens mid-trib when the two witnesses are killed. They're at the Temple Mount. And the Antichrist grows in there and causes the abomination of desolation. But brothers and sisters, we are not there yet. We are still living in the age of Jesus as our high priest. He is ever making intercession for us. He is coming to take the bride unto himself. We will be with the Lord during the 7-year tribulation. As Jesus said in Luke chapter 21, verse 36, talking about the tribulation, he said, watch therefore always and pray. Pray always that you be counted worthy to escape the tribulation. These things that we're talking about, and stand before the Son of Man. And brothers and sisters, there is an opportunity to be there with him. Revelation 3:10, Jesus speaking to the church of Philadelphia said, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour and trial of temptation that will come upon the whole earth to try all the people of the whole earth. The Lord will keep us out of it. The Greek word is ek, out of, not through, out of. Israel will be kept through it. The bride will be kept out of it, brothers and sisters. Delivered out of it. Oh, that's where it says, where Paul says that, you know, death will be swallowed up in victory at the resurrection of the saints, a.k.a. the rapture. It says, oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Death is swallowed up in victory. You know, God had put it into death for his church. We'll be out of here. Those who become Christians after that day will not be part of the church. That's why we call them tribulation saints. If you read in the book of Revelation, it talks about the saints. This is the wisdom and the patience of the saints, the tribulation saints. That's not the bride, brothers and sisters. That's not the church. The church age ends in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. We'll be changed from this. We will take off this corruptible flesh that is needs to be crucified and dead in the presence of God and put on incorruption. So when we see the Lord, we'll be as he is, John tells us, 1 John. When we see the Lord, we'll be like him. We'll be in our resurrected bodies. As Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, starting at verse 16, it says, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. That's people that's died, that's in heaven now, in a spirit body. They don't have a resurrected body. They're in a spirit body. They're not a material body like the resurrected body or like what we have now. The dead in Christ shall rise first. They will come down to get their bodies. There's lots of Bible verses to connect all this. I can do a teaching on it next time as the Lord leads me. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air. Wherefore, or therefore, shall we ever be with the Lord? Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Brothers and sisters, we're going home. You know, I just, you know, all those songs are in my mind. You know, when the roll is caught up yonder, I'll be there. That's an old hymnal song, you know. When the roll is caught up yonder, 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 I'll be there. That's one of those old hymnal songs. You know, brothers and sisters, when I first got in the ministry, I first got filled with the Holy Spirit, I didn't want to hear those songs because it's about us. You know, in the Lord, in my level and growth in the Lord, I was, you know, I want to sing praises to the Lord or worship the Lord. I don't hear any songs about the church, you know, about us. But there are seasons and times for everything, brothers and sisters. And there's a time to rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Have you? Has the Lord made you glad? Are you praising him? Are you worshiping? You know, there's another song. I just can't stop praising his name. I just can't stop praising his name. Oh, I just can't stop. It's an easy one. Praising the name of Jesus. You got to praise him. You know, you got to get under the spot where the glory comes out. Hallelujah. For the Spirit inhabits the praises of his people. You got to lift your voice in praise and song and give glory to his name. Hallelujah. And the Lord will answer you. Call upon me, he said, and I'll answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not. Jeremiah 33, a.k.a. God's phone number, is Jeremiah 33:3. Call upon me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not. Draw close to me and I'll draw close to you, he says. God wants to be near us and with us and walk with us and in us and through us. He wants to do all those things. It's a matter of faith. It's a matter of faith. You know, I had a brother just messaged me and said, can you pray for me because I don't believe in healing? Hebrews chapter 11, it says, have faith in God. It says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. How can you not believe that someone or some being can create the universe, send wisdom through man to write the Bible, to come down on earth, live as a man, live a sinless life and die on the cross, shedding his blood, taking the stripes and punishment that we deserve to deliver us from death, hell, and the grave, but yet don't believe that the Lord might heal somebody. God won't do miracles. God does all kinds of miracles all the time. The only thing limited is our faith. It's God's nature to heal. It's his nature to deliver. It's his nature to save. Everywhere Jesus went, he healed people. And he said, what? He said, be of good cheer. Thy faith has made you whole. Let it be according to your faith. That's a whole nother message that the Lord gave me. I got to do a little preaching, brothers and sisters. I've been doing a little singing. I got to do a little preaching. It's your faith. It's your faith. Hallelujah. Have faith in God. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Hallelujah. Knock, and it'll be open to you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, it'll be open to you. Ask, and you shall receive. Hallelujah. Have faith. Oh, ye of little faith. Hallelujah. What's the problem? Believe on God. Don't believe in yourself. Don't believe in the doctrines of men. Believe God. Hallelujah. He's the great I am. Creator of the universe loves people. It's crazy, but true. I can't tell God what to do and what not to do. But God loves people. He wants to save people. He wants to deliver people. He wants to bless people. Who are his people? Come unto him, all ye who are burdened and heavy laden, and he will give you rest. For his burden is easy and his yoke is light. Matthew chapter 11, said the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus said, you being evil, know how to give your children good gifts. How much more does your heavenly Father, who is perfect, love to give good gifts to his children? What part of good gifts don't you understand? What part don't you understand that God wants to bless his people? All this feigned humility. Humble yourselves and God will bless you. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Stop being prideful and arrogant and rejecting God's blessings in your life. God wants to bless you to make you a blessing. God told Abraham, I bless you to make you a blessing. How can you help the poor if you yourself have no dollar in your pocket? God's got to bless you in order for you to bless. People say, oh, it's a prosperity gospel. Prosperity gospel is, God, I need a Rolex on my arm to show that Jesus is Lord. That's prosperity. People going off the rail on the crazy train with prosperity. But God wants to bless us. Say, Lord, give me $1 million. I want to build 100 orphanages for you. God, give me $1 million. I want to give away 500,000 Bibles in Mexico, whatever. It's not prosperity. It's being used as a vessel for God, being used as an instrument. Get off your pity party. Start thinking about yourself and say, God, there's a greater thing than me. God is greater than me. His kingdom is greater than me. It's about the Lord and his glory and his kingdom and then others. And then last but not least, it's about me. Stop focusing on yourself. Stop throwing stones at other people. Get your mind off this world. Get your eyes on Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, turn your eyes upon Jesus and the things of this world will grow strangely dim. You know, as the song says, I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. The world behind me, the Lord before me. Hallelujah. The world is behind me. Get behind me, Satan. That's all I can say to the people of this world who are enemies of the cross, enemies of the gospel. Get behind me, Satan. Get underfoot in Jesus' name. For the Lord has given us authority to tread, to walk over the top of snakes and serpents and wicked people who are being used by snakes and serpents. We have the authority to walk right over their head. I'm going to walk over the top of the devil and his people right in to the gates of heaven. Hallelujah. Let's go in to the gates with thanksgiving in our heart. Let's enter his courts with praise. Let's say this is a day that the Lord has made. Let's be glad and rejoice in it. Hallelujah. Rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. That's a Bible verse and a song. Hallelujah. Praise God. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Hallelujah. For his kingdom is at hand, brothers and sisters. I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on, brothers and sisters. I feel like going to my heavenly home. Hallelujah. I'm ready to depart out of this world and be with Jesus, to be with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Lord, let it be so. Even so, Lord, come for your people. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. That's from the end of the book of Revelation. Even so, take your bride away. And how I long to be with you, my Lord. Even so. We praise you, Lord. The name of the song is Even So, but it's from the end of the book of Revelation. Even so, take your bride away. Praise you, Lord Jesus. We bless your holy name. God bless all you guys. You know that I love you guys. Hallelujah. I got to bring, the axe to the grindstone, that you might be sharpened, that the sword of the Spirit be sharpened in you. Hallelujah. Many people cannot endure chastisement. The Bible says, rebuke a fool and you'll receive his wrath. Rebuke a wise man and he'll take it to heart. Hallelujah. Praise God that we can receive. Bless, most of you guys were humble enough to receive correction. Praise God. The Lord corrects me all the time. I'm not ashamed to say it. I'm not God. I don't know everything. I only know what the Lord would show me and reveal to me. I only know as much as the Lord would let me know. Hallelujah. That he would trust me with his wisdom. That's all I know. All I know is God is exalted and Satan is defeated and Jesus Christ is Lord. That's all I know. Hallelujah. That's another song by Carmen. God is exalted and Satan is defeated and Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord on high. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into him and they are saved. Hallelujah. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into him and they are saved. Hallelujah. Put your faith and trust in Yeshua HaMashiach today. He will deliver you from the snare of the fowler, as it says there in Psalm 91. He will set your feet upon a rock and deliver you and show you his salvation. Hallelujah. For we are overcomers, more than conquerors, the Bible says. Through the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are free. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. Hallelujah. And he set us free. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Filled with the Holy Ghost I am. I'm under the blood. I've been redeemed. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Praise God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. Hallowed be his name, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. You got to come on up the mountain with me now. I'm calling you and telling you that the Lord is calling you to come up the mountain. Come on up the mountain. A lot of you are a little bit too far away to hear his voice. But he's speaking always. God speaks. Let there be light. He spoke, sent his word in the flesh. Hallelujah. God is always speaking. God does things by speaking. His word is his speaking. He prophesies. He speaks. The Bible says he calls those things that are not as if they are. He changed Abraham's name from Abram to Abraham, meaning father of many nations, and he had no kids. He was 75 years old with a 65-year-old wife with no children, and God said, hey, I'm changing your name to God, to father of many nations. He calls those things that are not as if they are. He called Jacob the heel grabber, the supplanter, changed his name and said, hey, your name is now Israel, he who wrestles with God and man and overcomes. Hallelujah. The nation of Israel is still wrestling with man, with all the Gentile nations, still wrestling with God by not receiving Jesus as a Messiah. But just as God spoke, it will come to pass, surely come to pass, that Israel will overcome when they accept Jesus as a Messiah. And they will rule and reign from their nation. They're in Israel for 1,000 years, and they will have victory over the Gentile nations too, because God spoke it. God calls those things that are not as if they are. Hallelujah. And God is still speaking for you. When you were yet a sinner, Christ died for you. When you were yet a sinner, Jesus had already called your name from the foundation of the world. You just didn't hear it until you answered the call. He already spoke it. Hallelujah. He called you, hey, my child, before you were saved. Hallelujah. Because he knew. He spoke it and it was. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. So begin to speak. The greatest act that a human can do like God is to speak the word of God. Animals can't talk. Only humans can speak. When you speak the word of God, only you are acting in the image of God. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whomsoever shall believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Only a human can do that. Only under the power of the Holy Spirit and this body that the Lord gave us can we speak those words. Praise God. And the word has power because it's his word. It's filled with the power of his Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Praise God. Be used as an instrument of God today. Speak his word with boldness by his Spirit. God bless you guys. That's my late Sunday sermon that I was going to do this morning, but I've been worshiping the Lord all day, as I said. Praise be God. Most High, love you guys. I'm praying for you, and I appreciate all your prayers. I appreciate all the feedback from those who got some oil, all the healings. Praise God. It's dozens of stories and praise reports already. Praise God for that. Praise God for our combined prayer over the oil, brothers and sisters. Our prayers are working. The Church of the Firstborn is doing something for the Lord. You know, we're bringing hope, the gospel, and the power of the Holy Spirit to his people. That's what we're here for, to be salt and light. Praise God and make disciples of the nations. Hallelujah. Prepare the bride to meet the Lord in the air. That's our commission, brothers and sisters. God bless you guys.